Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another edition of the Tanks World Podcast. And I have a guest today.
You do?
Yes. It is called Joe Bob, Jimmy Bob, Bo Bob.
Hi, Joe Bob, Jill Bob, Jim Bob, Joe Bob. Jim Bob. Nailed it.
No proto-metas here today, guys. So, and we are going to discuss a dumpster fire.
Yes, this is the fourth theatrical Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie. It's been a long time since we've done the third one.
Yep.
But granted, it was a long time between the releases of the third one and this fourth one, which...
A couple... Almost probably a decade? Almost
over a decade. This movie came out in 2007, and the third movie came out, I want to say, before the mid-90s, so...
We apologize the way we sound.
Daylight savings happened, and this movie is shit.
Yeah. So, instead of live action, they decided to go animated.
CGI animation.
Yes.
I assume that the impetus for this was, I guess, the 4Kids cartoon series that had been airing at around the same time was popular enough that they decided to make a movie that isn't connected to it?
Nope, not at all.
In fact, for the most part, this film kind of feels like it's a standalone thing, which works to its detriment because it doesn't feel like it's supposed to be a standalone movie.
No, it's not. There, the only thing about this movie that kind of, you know, brings up like the Turtles franchise is the foot and the turtles.
Like, we get a brief explanation of the turtles' backstory, how they fought and defeated the Shredder, which explains why Shredder's nowhere to be seen in this movie outside of the opening sequence.
It should have, you know, it would have been better if he probably was
in it. That's one of the big issues that I have with this movie. It's like, they explain the backstory for anybody who doesn't know who the turtles are, but they don't do it enough to really give you a good idea. That isn't until, like, the ending, which we'll get to that soon enough.
Yeah.
But the bulk of the backstory goes to explaining how this ancient evil dude opened a portal to another dimension that and summoned demons, which resulted in his four generals being turned into stone and him being immortal. And 13 demons being let loose upon the earth, which...
Where the hell were the demons the entire time?
Apparently they were around terrorizing Earth, which is why no one had ever heard of them ever before. I mean, I'm presuming that the explanation is that they're the explanation for, like, cryptids and other various types of folklore myths or something. But the movie doesn't really explain it that
well.
No,
they're monsters! And not, real monsters, because that would be good.
But, so yeah, that happened like 3,000 years ago.
Yep. And then we get to,
South America.
South America, where Leo is protecting a small village, town,
from, bad guys.
Yes. And
dictator bad guys.
Yeah.
Kind of stereotypical characters, if I'm going to be completely honest.
A little bit.
It's like, wow, you could have been maybe a bit more subtle with this.
Yeah.
It feels a bit on the nose. Uncomfortably so.
Yeah. Then a few moments later, April O'Neil is walking through the same forest and falls into a trap. Or not a trap, just a pit. Then is rescued by Leo.
Who has apparently been living in South America for over a year since Splinter sent him down there on some training mission to become a better leader. And he feels that he has failed in this endeavor.
I don't see how this training really works.
I don't understand what the purpose of the training was either. Mm. I don't know how it could have led Leo to be a better leader. I don't know Why?
It seems like it makes it more of a better protector than a leader.
But what really kills me is the reason that Leo hasn't gone back to New York is because he feels he failed in this training mission. Mm-hmm. But the movie never actually explains why he feels like he failed.
No, it never comes back up again after he comes back. Well, April and Leo are sitting by a fire, and he's asking, so how are the guys doing, you know?
Donnie's an IT guy over the phone, yep. Which,
you know. Honestly, I'm not a big fan of this movie, but, you know, him being a tech is actually perfect.
Yeah, I will admit that is actually something that feels spot on for the kind of career that Donnie could get into.
He ends up trying to explain to the person over the phone, have you plugged in your computer? Oh, no. Well, that might help.
Yeah, it's a kind of
you know,
telehelper type situation. Like, sir, have you tried turning your computer off and on again type situations?
Yeah.
Except from the, you know, operator's perspective and not the customer.
I am not trying to argue with you. I am just Donnie. I'm trying to help you. Mikey dresses up as a turtle for birthday parties.
So he's basically the Ghostbusters from Ghostbusters 2 at the beginning of the movie.
Yep.
Except nobody knows that he's actually a turtle.
Yep, and he just gets beat up with
foam bats, I guess.
Foam bats, maybe, like,
it is not a glamorous career for him.
No. And Raph is a vigilante.
Though nobody realizes that, even though a mysterious vigilante has shown up after the turtles stopped being mysterious vigilantes. Mm-hmm. No one suspects this.
He is the Night Watcher,
Night Watcher, Night Watchman. I think it's Night Watcher because when Leo comes back, he keeps referring to it as the Night Watchman.
Yeah.
And keeps getting corrected by the other characters. Yeah. So yeah, Leo does return because obviously this movie is called TMNT.
Yeah.
Also, admittedly, the fact that they decided to go with the abbreviation does kind of cut out the fact that
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Well, it cuts out the fact that they're explicitly stated to be teenagers because they're not.
No, they're actually quite young.
No, in this movie, it's implied that they're like adult age.
Ah, yeah, that makes sense.
I mean, they're trying to hold down jobs and all that.
Also, the other, before the live-action turtle show, I'm having a break.
Next Mutation.
Yeah. They're pretty much adult age there.
Yeah. Anyway, let's move on.
Yeah. So, Leo shows back up in the den, and, you know, Splinter talks with him, and pretty much him coming home, I believe, is the training.
I don't really know. I mean, the fact that Leo returns kind of comes as a surprise because in between April talking with Leo and him returning, April goes back to America with a statue that she delivers to the guy who 3,000 years ago used to be the conqueror, mm-hmm. and now he's played by Patrick Stewart.
Yeah.
Who feels out of place. He feels too good for this movie.
Yeah.
I don't think that the voice quite fits the character, and he's clearly probably the best paid actor in this film. Mm-hmm. Him or Lawrence Fishburne, who plays the narrator. They feel too good for this movie. Also, April is voiced by Sarah Michelle Gellar. Mm-hmm. April is in a relationship with Casey Jones, played by Chris Evans. So that's probably why you recognized him.
Oh, that's Chris.
Yeah.
And
the turtles are played by just regular voice actors, which...
Fine. And Splinter is a voice...
No, it's not fine, because it means that they get listed in the credits after the higher paid actors.
Yeah.
So it's like the lead characters of this movie get shoved down into the credits because they're not big name on screen actors. They're regular voice actors.
Yeah.
That is a piece of shit. Mm-hmm. Because god damn it. The ones who are putting the most time and effort into making their characters work and failing in some regards are... it just goes to show you how poorly voice actors are treated compared to on-screen actors.
Yeah, pretty much. Okay, so... they get told to go and train above ground, because since Leo apparently left, they were told to stay underground and not deal with anything.
Also, I think before that, Casey goes out and encounters the Night Watcher, who he immediately recognizes as Raph.
How'd you know it was me? Just like, you look like a giant metal turtle.
Which feels stupid later on in the movie that he's the only one who actually figures it out just by process of elimination. And it's dumb. This movie is dumb.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the turtles go out on a night mission to not really do anything. They're not supposed to be going out fighting crime.
They encounter one of the demons, monsters, or whatever the fuck you want to call them.
Being fought by the Foot Clan, led by Karai. Mm-hmm. If you don't know who Karai is, I mean, admittedly, you probably watched the original cartoon and the live-action movies and nothing else.
Yep.
Because she has shown up a lot more post-boom.
Yeah.
And here she is. Yep. Here she is.
Yep. She's the new leader of the Foot, so yeah. The turtles try to help Karai and the Foot soldiers fight this thing, and then statue people
who have just recently been resurrected from ancient times show up to capture the monster, because apparently the big what is his fucking name? Winters?
Sure.
Let's go with Winters. Winters, who we already know is the ancient overlord, had resurrected his four generals to capture the 13 demons so that they could perform the same ritual that they did 3,000 years ago that cursed him with immortality and cursed them to become stones. So they capture one.
Yep.
And then proceed to capture like the next nine or so.
Yeah.
Via a montage, with the turtles barely being involved.
Yep.
Like, the turtles get into a fight with this monster and the Foot, and then the stone guys take over, and Splinter's mad, and just kind of rushes through it, which makes me question why there were 13 demons. I mean, shit, I couldn't even be bothered to remember the traits of half of the stone warriors. Because of how little they get.
The big one is the powerhouse. The one that looks like it's got a mane, I think, is the fast one. And then there's the female.
And then there's the lead one, played by Kevin Michael Richardson.
Yep. second in command, I suppose. Fuck, I don't know.
Yeah, this movie feels like it probably could have benefited from being like a mini series rather than a movie, to be honest. Maybe flesh some stuff out a bit. Maybe show the demons, the monsters actually terrorizing people instead of just saying it, and then they just show up in New York after Winters gets all four soldiers.
Yeah.
Because that's the first time we really see the monsters show up in the city. It's after Winters gets all four of his soldiers back. And we only get to see him get one back, because apparently he's already had the other three, and he sent April to get the last one.
Pretty much what... Oh, when April and Casey are delivering the statue, Casey accidentally bumps a pot of some sort, and
some ancient pottery that shatters.
And then the building goes on lockdown.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Then Winters pretty much flirts with April, etc., etc. Let's move on.
Yeah, admittedly, we're kind of doing stuff a bit out of order, but we don't fucking care because this is TMNT. And not the good kind of that abbreviation. We're talking specifically about the movie, which is a piece of shit. And Kato, who voices Splinter, actually does a pretty good job. I mean,
even though he was going through throat cancer at the time, he did a great...
Yeah, he passed away before this movie came out because there's a dedication to him at the end.
Yep.
He voiced some great characters in his time. And I know the nostalgia critic caught some shit when he didn't know that when he reviewed the movie.
Yeah, he apologized.
He rather accurately said that Splinter sounded like somebody with throat cancer.
He kind of did.
I mean, it was accurate, but he did not know. But thanks to watching that review, that's like the one thing I actually remembered about this movie.
They get the 13 or 11? No. No, they get 12.
They get most of the other monsters via montage, like we said. That just feels super rushed and just like... I was like only half paying attention to it the first time I was watching it. I'm pretty sure I had left the room while it was happening the second time we watched it together.
Yeah. You were still waiting for your DVD to rip. And I kept telling you, it hasn't moved any yet.
No, you kept guessing that that's what was going on.
Yeah.
I was merely confirming that that was the case. And that was far more interesting than this movie.
Yeah. Raph and Casey encounter one of the,
I think it's just Raph who encounters him.
Well, no, there's a scene where they're on the roof.
Yeah, but that's because that happened earlier, and that's... We kind of mentioned that, because... Okay, so Raph, as Night Watcher, catches a crook that he had caught earlier trying to commit another crime, and then Casey and Raph get into a brief fight, which...
It's more of a verbal argument.
It's a very brief fight because Raph immediately realizes that Casey has figured out who he is immediately. Yeah. So it's like, okay. It's like no point extending this fight.
Yep. Okay, then. Well, Raph gets tranked by something. And
that happens a lot.
Well, the stone people notice them on the roof.
Okay, so they encounter one of the other instances.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I guess I completely blanked that part out of the movie because fuck this movie. So yeah, they get into a fight with the stone guys in the foot, and Raph gets tranked.
And then that's when April and Casey find out Leo's back.
Right, because he hadn't shown up before them just yet. Because Casey takes Raph back to their apartment.
Mm-hmm.
April calls Donnie, who then gets everybody to show up at April's apartment so they can try figuring stuff out. They figure out that it's Winters because his name is literally on the dart.
He's like, it's Winters. How do you know?
Winters' name is all over this thing. How can you tell? Because Winter's name is all over this thing.
Oh, Donnie.
It's like, no, literally, it's right here.
Yep. It's like an Iron Man where, like, the Stark missile. Oh, shit. So Leo tries to pretty much wake or check on Raph. They find a big, like, thing stuck in Raph's shell.
It was like half a throwing star or something, which April recognizes as having come from the ancient times, and she even recognized footage of the ancient soldiers from the news. Splinter had at one point figured out that the turtles went out because he sees a news report about monsters showing up.
It was like, and boys!
Immediately assumes that the turtles were involved, even though technically there was a monster involved.
Yeah.
They don't even show footage of the monster, which, you know, could give the turtles plausible deniability for having gone out. But nope, he immediately...
Yes.
This movie is crap.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. So they...
They're trying to figure stuff out, and Raph decides to go out.
Raph literally quits.
I quit. So then Splinter tells Leo, oh, you gotta go get Raph, because your team is... You're being a shit leader for not having all your team. It's like...
Doesn't help that Raph doesn't want anything to do with Leo.
Like the way Splinter is acting, he makes it seem like it's Leo's fault that Raph is being a rogue agent and Splinter doesn't even want to hear excuses. Like, no excuses, you're the leader. This guy is not even trying to listen to me. Yeah. It's literally not my fault.
So, at this point in time, Raph is on his motorcycle and just driving, and he notices that there's a something going on in the diner. There's this scene. It's fun. This scene is funny. But even before Raph even shows up, there's just a random customer there just reading the newspaper as everything is going on in the kitchen.
You got a little like pink demon looking thing just kind of terrorizing the place.
Just like
Raph comes in to break up the fight. We get an okay fight scene.
And then he tries to leave
to chase after the demon because that's run off and the guy who runs the diner is terrified of him because
he's thinking he's getting robbed. And
Raph is upset. He's like, I'm trying to help you.
Yep.
God damn.
And then like
Then Leo shows up to throw darts at him.
Yep.
Thinking that he's the Night Watcher. Mm-hmm. Then they get into a fight. Mm-hmm. And then
Leo gets the upper hand by uppercutting Donnie's helmet off. Raph's helmet off. And then he goes, Raph?
It's like, no shit, it's the one guy who's sleeping all day and disappearing at night. It's like, freaking even Casey fucking Jones pieced this shit together, and he didn't even have to unmask Raph. It's like, how the fuck did nobody else figure this out?
Mm-hmm. And then...
Legitimately, when I first saw this movie, I was under the assumption that Leo was getting into the fight with a Night Watcher because he knew it was Raph. So then when the helmet comes off and Raph's identity exposed, I was like, wait, no shit, you didn't realize it was the one character that it obviously was? What the fuck is wrong with you?
So So they get into a fight. Raph ends up breaking Leo's katanas, and then he walks away, and then Leo gets
darted and taken by the Stone Warriors, who are like, well, this is obviously not the last monster we need, but let's take him anyway.
Yeah, it's not.
Because I guess the Stone Warriors caught the pink demon off screen or something. I don't fucking know, because the last monster is certainly not the small pink guy.
No, it's borderline a kaiju.
But the Stone Warriors is like, they basically realize the Stone War. Okay, by this point, the Stone Warriors have realized that Winters is not going to try and conquer the world again. They think he's gone soft in the 3,000 years that he's been immortal. So they're planning on upsetting the ritual to, I guess, summon more demons and keep the curse going, because they're Stone Warriors who have just been resurrected. They're fine. They got nothing. They got nothing to lose.
They're immortal too now.
Basically, it's just like.
So
So they decide to use Leo as the fake 13th monster in order to trick Winters.
Then Wrath goes to back to the den and tells Splinter what he did.
And so everybody has to go to rescue Leo, thereby proving that Leo is the true leader, even though he's out of commission for the for pretty much a good chunk of the
Well, after they get him fight. Out, get him out of the pod.
But it's like,
yes. They join forces with Casey Jones and April and.
I think they briefly get into a fight with the foot soldiers until the stone soldiers reveal their treachery to Winters, at which point they switch to helping the turtles.
Yeah,
and so Casey and April go out to go get the 13th monster.
By the way, where the hell did they know where it was?
Fuck this movie.
Then
that's your answer. Fuck this movie.
The turtles end up holding their own against the stoned warriors, and
Karai and the couple are able to bring the monster back and get it into position in order to close up the portal, thus ending the curse.
The soldiers were inside the portal, they turned back to normal and then just died.
Yeah, they turn back to normal as the ritual is being completed and basically turn to light.
Yep.
To light particles. And then Winters also turns into light particles, but not before thanking April and being like, "Oh, I always knew you could do this. I specifically chose you for this task because I knew you could do it." And blah, blah, blah.
Casey's like, "I knew it."
And then he turns to light, and so Splinter takes his helmet and puts it on a shelf, at which point it's revealed that this is in continuity with the 3 live-action movies that came out in the 90s. I was like, oh! So that's where all that backstory was hiding. In an Easter egg. Fuck this movie!
I don't recommend this.
No!
I recommend the 3 others.
The 3 others were good. The third one, for as flawed as it is, at least
it's an alright story.
It's a well executed story for the story it's trying to tell. It understands the assignment. This movie has too much that's happening, but not enough time to really let it settle.
Yeah.
Also, Donnie and Mikey are here.
Oh yeah, they kind of just go away after a while.
They are. Basically side characters throughout this entire movie, which is fucking ironic because of the fact that fucking on the poster fucking Mikey is front and center before anybody else. Like Mikey and Donnie are at the forefront. Leo and
Raph are in the back.
Leo and Raph are behind them, and behind them are like the foot soldiers.
It doesn't show anything about the rock people in the cover or the back, I don't think.
Yeah, no, it's like... No. So it's like, fuck this movie.
Alright, yeah. I recommend the 3 other ones.
Yeah, skip this one. This is a piece of shit.
And we'll discuss the other Turtles movies that will come out eventually some other time. If you want to watch some of the cartoons, read some of the comics, and get the actual lore.
Yeah, I've been actually watching the first Nickelodeon cartoon series. That one has been great. Been having a lot of fun with that. Rob Paulsen returns, not as his character from the original 80s cartoon, but as a different character, but one of the Turtles, and he does a great job with it.
Oh, good.
So, yeah, no, it's...
Okay, this movie. Just because we don't like this movie doesn't mean that you guys, if you guys like it, go ahead and like it, you know, but it's not our cup of tea.
Yeah, but here's the thing. They were planning on making a sequel to this, and this movie did so poorly that that shot any plans for that out the window.
Yeah, yeah, kind of backfired on.
One of the major problems I have is, like, again, there is clearly not enough time to give every character all the focus, which results in, you know, Mikey and Donnie being side characters in a movie that's in favor of Raph and Leo being the lead characters.
Yeah.
The whole hunt for the monsters happens via montage for the most part, when it could have been more spread out. You know, actually showing the monsters terrorizing people before coming to New York for some reason. The movie never actually explains why the monsters are now suddenly converging on New York.
Yeah.
Like, I think
I mentioned maybe the weird emblem things he put on the, like, stone soldiers.
It's possible. I'm not going to deny that. But the movie doesn't properly explain it. And that is a problem.
Yeah. What was the plot of this movie? Was there a plot?
Some ancient guy is trying to undo a curse, and the turtles get involved.
Yeah.
Also, family dispute between Raph and Leo over leadership.
Yeah.
That's the summary of the entire movie. If you skipped right to the end for some reason, there you go. You don't even have to read this podcast. You don't have to watch a movie. You don't have to listen to this podcast or read it if somebody has transcribed it. I don't fucking know. Maybe you're watching this with captions. I don't. Who knows?
Well, with all your swearing, it's gonna be half of the censored.
Well, can you blame me? I mean, fuck this movie.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we'll be probably talking about the Bay ones some other year, but so I guess I don't have much more to say about this. So
you wanted to take a bit of time?
Oh yes, we have a recommendation for you to read Dr. Slump.
Dragon Ball.
Watch and read Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z and, you know, all them. Because, R.I.P. To one of the legends.
Akira Toriyama passed away at the beginning of this month.
Mm-hmm.
He was a major influence in pretty much the entire world at this point.
Oh, yeah. Twitter was going nuts.
He was an inspiration to other manga artists such as Ichiro Oda, who did One Piece, and Masashi Kishimoto, who did Naruto.
Mm-hmm.
They have both cited his influence for their impressively successful works.
And all of his designs on video game
the Dragon Quest series, Chrono Trigger, Blue Dragon.
Mm-hmm. Just, yeah. Thank you, and you will be missed.